Welcome to Macro Musings, the podcast series where each week we pull back the curtain and take a closer look at the important macroeconomic issues of the past, present, and future. I'm your host, David Beckworth of the Mercatus Center. We are glad you've decided to join us. Our guest today is Nick Bunker. Nick is an economist at the Indeed Hiring Lab who focuses on the U.S. labor market. He was previously a senior policy analyst at the Washington Center for Equitable Growth, an economics think tank. Nick joins us today to talk about the U.S. labor market. Nick, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me on.
Glad to have you on. And Nick, what is your handle on Twitter for those who want to know?
It's Nick_Bunker. So it's my name, which is an underscore in between the first and last name.
Okay. And you want to follow Nick because he's a big labor market guy. And as we'll talk about later, he's a big JOLTS Day promoter versus the Jobs Day numbers. But we'll come to that later. But Nick, tell us about your journey into economics, into the economic policy world. You've worked at think tanks. So tell us what got you here.
Yeah. So when I entered college, I had these kind of grand ambitions of being a diplomat. I was majoring in international affairs. And thankfully, now in hindsight, the program I was in essentially required you to take a number of economics courses just to get that background. And essentially, after my end of my freshman year, beginning of my sophomore year, I was like, I actually like the economics courses the most. This is the thing I'm really interested in. And eventually decided, you know what? I should just go with what I'm interested in. And I switched my major to economics. And that was in the spring of 2008. So,
wow.
An interesting time to develop an interest in economics. So, the financial crisis happened, the Great Recession, in particular with the labor market, there was that huge spike in unemployment, also around the time that I happened to be graduating college. So, you know, academic interest became very personal very quickly. And I ended up working at a think tank out of college and just developed this interest in, you know, economic policies. You know, broadly, but specifically the labor market. And this question, I think, of the cyclical in the wake of the Great Recession, all this damage we've done to the labor market, how much can be repaired by, you know, stronger macro policy, monetary policy, fiscal policy, and how much is just structural, these longer term issues that other policymakers are going to have to tangle with. And that's, now that I'm indeed looking at, you know, data on the labor market, either in the publicly available data that you get from BLS or the internal proprietary data that we have Indeed. So it's a job search website. So we have data on what people are searching for and also data on what employers are posting. So it's this great opportunity to look at what's going on in the labor market, combining these data sets, sometimes just the proprietary, sometimes just the public, and just trying to understand what's going on in the labor market right now and like what's the really important stories out there that we need to be focusing on.
This must be a great place to be for a data nerd like yourself.
Oh, it is amazing. It is, yeah. You know, people, and before I had this job, people felt like big data and all that stuff. And then to actually have the opportunity to work with it, it's exciting. It's having most of my data experience was with, you know, publicly available data. So the current population.
Like the rest of us.
Yeah. Yes. And that's, you know, governments, economists and statisticians have gone through and like really worked. Like things are seasonally adjusted. There's all these attention paid to like quirks or interesting things. Proprietary data, no one's done that. You're doing that too. So it's been really interesting to, in the few months I've been in with the hiring lab so far, to really dive into that. So it's not only just, oh, look, this CPS micro data has been cleaned for me. In fact, you have to go in and like
clean it yourself. Yeah.
Clean it yourself and figure out the kind of quirks, which is really interesting. And then doing kind of like, okay, well, now what does this tell us about the labor market?
So tell us more about the hiring lab. What you've described what you do, but what is the general goal and objectives of the center?
Yeah. So the hiring lab is a team within Indeed that, our goal and mission is to, kind of help lead the global labor market conversation that, to help basically find the most interesting stories that are going on in the labor market, not only in the US, but we have economists in the UK, France, Germany, and Australia.
Okay.
So it's, you know, it's truly global trying to understand what's going on in all these different markets and then, you know, get this news out into the world as to what's going on.
Because I guess you have searches from all over the world and you have data from all over the world. Okay.
Yeah. So actually one of the first piece I published with the hiring lab was looking at, you know, the Trump administration has taken, you know, in both rhetoric and policy, kind of an anti-immigration stance. So what, because we have data on, you know, searches outside the US, and we can tell what, if they are searching into the United States, seeing, has there been any change in international interest in the US since 2016? Has that gone down?
And
some countries, Latin American countries in particular, if you're searching outside your country, Latin American searchers are less likely to look to the US. Overall, it's fairly flat, but Latin American countries is down. Makes some sense.
Makes a lot of sense.
Mexico, in particular, like Mexico's gone down. Other kind of countries from South America. But what's interesting is the Muslim majority countries that we have data on, there's no clear trend. Some of them, interest has gone up, some's gone down.
So you'd think the Muslim countries you would see as a downward.
And we don't have data on any of the countries that were on the travel ban. But for example, Oman, which is like next to Yemen, which is on the travel ban, actually interest in the U.S. was up a little bit.
Well, I guess also maybe there's some selection effects, or the people who actually search on Indeed are going to be people who are educated, likely to get a work visa.
Yeah. So it's, but I think the time trend analysis was trying to figure out, okay, maybe that's been like a steady cohort over time and trying to figure out.
Sounds very interesting though.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, it's exciting. You can't, there's no government data on what people are actually searching for and interested.
Yeah, you know, I've wondered, and I know there are people who've talked about this, and I'm sure some of our listeners will let me know about my ignorance on this topic, but it seems to me one of the things that the government should be spending more money on is real-time data collection. Mm-hmm. I know there's some efforts being made, but, you know, hedge funds do this. I have a former student who works for a hedge fund, mm-hmm. and they take real-time data from all these credit card transactions and from other sources, and they have a much better sense of what's happening with economic activity in real time. Satellite images. I mean, there's lots of work being done on this. If there'd be some way to incorporate all this into some kind of real-time metrics that would better inform Federal Reserve policy, fiscal policy, all those things.
Yeah, I totally agree. You think public data is kind of a great example of a public good that, you know, the government can help create, and it like helps not only policymakers but businesses too, just to see what's going on in the world. And you've like actual investment in these kind of data infrastructure has been flat to down over the last couple of years. And it's one of those things that you'd hope there'd be more investment in, because BLS and BEA and Census do great work. There's definitely, for I think a good example of this is, you know, you often hear these conversations about the gig economy or new different kinds of work arrangements. Just this year, we got a survey from BLS on the contingent workers, basically people who are contractors, non-traditional work arrangements. That survey hadn't been done for 13 years prior to that because the BLS didn't have the budget for it. And essentially, we're in this spot where policymakers and the kind of labor market conversation was pointing out, this looks like it's an important trend, but we don't have any data on it because the last time you did it was 2005.
Wow.
And in fact, you had researchers, Alan Krueger and Larry Katz, basically said, we need this data. And they went out and they replicated the BLS survey to try to actually find trends. And then BLS, there was an effort. Congress basically said, we should fund this to have an actual government data source on it. So it's I think that's one of the issues, is not only this real-time data that you were mentioning, that'd be fantastic, but there's other just surveys or like kind of expansions of already existing public data that would be fantastically useful. There's just not enough resources right now.
And it's hard to justify these things to any kind of politician, whether it's President Trump or otherwise, because you don't see the immediate benefit, at least politically. But it's important both for, making the right policy decisions. I mean, the Federal Reserve needs to know in real time what's happening. But even like the private sector would benefit from this information, right? So making long-term investment decisions, I think it's very useful. So it's part of, I guess, our job to communicate the importance of data. Yep. You're on the front line, Nick. You're on the front line of labor data. So let's talk about labor market data. And many of our listeners will understand these metrics, but I'm going to work our way through for some who don't, and maybe to help us understand better what we already know. So I'm going to work through some of the standard measures of the labor market, and you tell me what they are, whether you're good, dated, useful. And let's begin with the standard unemployment rate measure. What do we know about that?
So every month we have Jobs Day. It is on it's usually the first Friday of the month, and the BLS, the Bureau of Labor Statistics, releases data on the labor, on the U.S. labor market the month before. So this upcoming Friday, we're recording this at the end of September, so it'll be the first week of October. We'll get data on September.
Okay.
So when these releases come out, basically most of the time you'll hear, if you're just casually following the news, you'll hear two numbers. The first one's probably the unemployment rate. So that's the most recent data we have. It's 3.9%. So that's 3.9% of people who are in the labor force are unemployed. Let's unpack that a little bit. So what's the labor force? So I think sometimes people hear the unemployment rate and they just assume, oh, you count up all the people and 3.9% of them don't have a job. That's not actually what's happening. So the unemployment rate comes from this survey called the Current Population Survey. And what they do is they it's basically people 16 and above. It's a representative sample. And they ask you, do you have a job? Okay, yeah, I have a job. Do you not have a job? Okay, no. Have you looked for a job in, like, recently, basically in the past month? Have you searched? Okay, if you don't have a job and you search, you're unemployed. If you haven't searched recently, you're officially not unemployed, because the idea here is that you want to have a measure of people who are actively searching for a job but just can't get it. So those people who are employed and those people who don't have a job and are actively searching for one, those people are in the labor force. Then you take that number, labor force, and you say, okay, of all those people who don't, you take all the officially unemployed people and you divide that by the labor force, by the total labor force. So right now it's 3.9% of people who have a job or don't have a job and are actively looking for one are in that latter quarter. They don't have one. So that, you know, is an indication of, hey, there's this many people either like want a job because they have one or want a job and they don't have one.
Can't find it, yeah.
So that's you know, indication of like supply, that these people want to supply their labor, and a higher unemployment rate is a larger percent of these people don't have work. And when it gets smaller, it's that, you know, fewer of these people, that there's less slack, that there's fewer people out there who are like, who are looking for one who don't have one. And when you take the labor force and you divide it by, you know, the whole population, that's the labor force participation rate.
And that number is never going to be 1 or 100%.
Yes.
Because there's old people who don't work. There's students.
There's people in college. Okay. There's people in high school.
People who voluntarily don't want to be working for whatever reason.
Yeah. And that's part of the reason why the unemployment rate is as a share of the labor force. So you don't – most of the time you don't want to have a measure that's counting, you know, 20-year-olds who are in college as unemployed, because – the sense you want from an unemployment rate is, you know, these people would like a job, but they don't have one. And including those people who are like, who are thinking, well, I don't need a job right now, or I don't want a job because I'm in school, or I've retired, I'm reached that point in life where I'm no longer. You don't want to necessarily include those
people. So what's the problem? There's been a lot of debate. It's well known to many listeners probably, but for those who don't know, what is the problem with the standard unemployment rate measure?
So you would think in normal times, okay, well, that labor force participation rate, that's going to be fairly steady. So that changes in the number of people who are unemployed, you know, if it goes down, then the unemployment rate goes down. If it goes up, then the unemployment rate goes up. The issue is that the labor force participation rate has changed. It also has a trend. And it's been, for the last several decades, in particular, the aggregate since 2000, has been going down. So sometimes there's going to be, in particular, since the Great Recession, what you saw is, as the, you know, labor market started recovering, you saw a drop in the unemployment rate. There were, by that measure, you saw, okay, there's fewer people who want a job, not having one. The issue is that also the labor force participation rate was low and declining, so that there were people what's dropping out of the labor force, is what we call. So the unemployment rate is going down, but then if you do a really simple, just, hey, here's all these people, what percent of them have a job? It was flat, because there are all these people. You think about it this way. There's, say, 50 people who are, let's say there's 5 people who are unemployed, and there's 100 people in the labor force. That's an unemployment rate of 5%. Now imagine someone who's unemployed drops out, and they say, I just can't find a job. They're going to not actively search anymore, and they're, according to the BLS definition, the traditional definition, which makes sense in normal times, you know, they're not unemployed. They are just out of the labor force. So then that number, instead of being 5 out of 100, is 4 out of 99. That number's small. That's below 5%. So the unemployment rate in that situation is telling you, oh, the unemployment rate's...
Things look great, but they're not
Yeah, it went down. But, well, it went down because of discouraged workers, not because that person got a job.
So make this concrete. In a counterfactual world, a young Nick Bunker gets out of school in 2008. He can't find work. He gets discouraged. At some point, he just gives up his dream of becoming a great, you know, blogger, think tank person is completely gone. And so knock, knock, here's the BLS person on Nick's door. Nick, are you looking for work? No. You know, and so Nick is completely swept aside. He's, in other words, you would be considered the same as the grandparent who has retired or the student who voluntarily. So you get confused. You get, you know, put in the wrong grouping, the wrong bucket, right?
Yeah. If you look at that kind of binary distinction of like in the labor force or not in the labor force, then yeah, that the, you know, as I said earlier, that sometimes you don't want to include those people who are like out of the labor force not participating because they might not want to work. But I think in your situation, young hypothetical counterfactual Nick would want to work and would want to supply labor to the labor market. But he, counterfactual me, isn't. He would like to, but he can't. So that, you know, he is getting counted as like not unemployed, even though if, say, there were more job opportunities, then I would re-enter the labor market and then all of a sudden get counted as unemployed.
And that's what's going on right now, right? So we have this really low unemployment rate. Mm-hmm. It's low by historical standards. But what we think we see happening is there's all these people who are sitting on the sidelines who are coming back in. And there may be a lot more out there than we previously thought, right?
Yeah, this is actually something that Jay Powell, chairman of the Federal Reserve, mentioned in his recent press conference after the September FOMC meeting, that part of what's going on is the population's been aging. So more people have been like flowing out of the labor force, but that's because part of that is due to, you know, people being older and retiring. But since basically the end of 2013 to 2018, that labor force participation rate has been flat. You would have expected it if you just looked at demographics, like people are getting older. Okay, well, it's going to trickle down, but actually flattened out. So what that means is that people who are, you know, in their prime working years, actually that participation rate has been going up. So as the labor market got stronger, it looks like people were starting getting pulled back in. And there's an interesting blog post column kind of research note from a few economists at the New York Fed that basically looked at, okay, if kind of another way of quantifying this effect of does a stronger labor market actually, you know, pull up the labor force participation rate. And what they found is that once people realized that you can see in the data that the rate at which unemployed people are getting a job, as that increased, as the labor market got tighter, more people seemed to re-enter the labor market because they're realizing, hey, these people who are officially unemployed are getting a job. Maybe I can re-enter and have there's more job opportunities out there. So I'll get back in. So the labor force participation rate goes up.
Yeah, I know we're getting in the weeds, but I think this is a big point. I was going to bring it up later, but let's talk about it now. This is a hugely consequential point for policymakers, for the Federal Reserve in particular, but you could argue for fiscal policy as well. But you know, the Fed was thinking back in 2010, 2011, 12, at least there was pressure on them to really begin tightening, quit QE, start raising rates, because the unemployment rate at this point, it's no longer about the Great Recession. I mean, we're 2-3 years out from the Great Recession. It's all structural. The only reason it's going to meaningfully change is because of age, demographics.
Yeah.
So if you took that view, then there's really nothing more the Federal Reserve could do. They've kind of wiped out the residual from the Great Recession. It's all about age. But what have we actually seen? I mean, what you just said, right?
Yeah. So I think there's this, you know, structural story that I think, you know, 2012, 2013, 2014, kind of people looking at the unemployment rate, it's 5 point something. that looks fine. You know, there's scarring from the Great Recession. This labor force participation rate is going to keep going down. There's studies by some Fed economists in like 2014.
Yeah, I'll mention some names here.
Yeah, David has a printout of it.
Aaron Aronson et al., Labor Force Participation, Recent Developments and Future Prospects in 2014. Yeah, what did they come up with?
Yeah, so they... this is, you know, you wish you had like graphs on a, like a podcast, just yeah. like some audio version of it. But you, this like kind of straight down line of the population's aging, participation rate is going to keep going down.
Right.
You can, in fact, some people on Twitter have draw a line of what they thought, you know, this decreasing participation rate and then what actually happened, which is a flattening out of people actually
coming
remaining
back
attached or coming back into the labor force. And that's millions of workers that if
right.
you... If you thought, if your thinking was, oh, no one's coming back, this is, we should just take it as it is. This participation rate policy really can't, like short-term macro policy can't really push on it that much. Millions of workers who perhaps seemingly would have just been stayed out of the labor force and perhaps wouldn't have gotten a job. And that's millions of lives that
right.
would have been deeply affected by, you know, arguments about what I'm sure some of the listeners like, a very arcane or seemingly strange topic, that it's understanding the dynamics of these things actually have huge ramifications for policy and people's lives. That, you know, that line going straight is millions of people getting jobs.
Yeah, to be blunt, if this study was from the Brookings Center, it was an article that was presented there by these economists from the Federal Reserve, the researchers there, if this article had been taken verbatim and followed to its policy conclusion, the Fed would have tightened a lot sooner, a lot quicker, and there would literally be millions of people who, since this study, who've now come into the labor force who probably would not have come in because the economy would have been weaker. Is that fair assessment?
Yeah. I think that's fair, and I mentioned
but that's stark. I mean, that's why it's important to get these metrics right.
Yeah, it's and that's part of the reason why I can get riled up talking about these issues because it's
now
it's
you important. Mentioned so that unemployment rate measure it's we still look at it. It comes out every month, as you said. It's called mm-hmm. the U3.
Mm-hmm.
Now the government has tried to, you know, get a little bit better. Tell us about this. They have another unemployment measure called the U6 unemployment measure. Now, how is that different than the standard one?
Yeah, so they have a whole panoply of
U6. Let's just jump to U6
yeah.
for the sake of time. But what's the U6?
So U6 is you take, all right, here's all the people who are officially unemployed, and then you add people who are marginally attached to the labor force and discouraged, so people who have, you know, would want a job but haven't looked recently or past 12 months or haven't looked recently enough to be counted as unemployed but like have shown a desire to get a job, and then people who are working part-time for economic reasons. So that's people who are working part-time hours but would like full-time hours but just haven't got the opportunity to get it. And then that's divided by the labor force plus the people.
Okay, so going back to my counterfactual example of Nick Bunker, the college graduate who had a hard time in the Great Recession, you would then be included in one of this measure, arguably, right?
Yeah, so if I responded to the person asking the CBS questions that, oh, I don't have a job, I haven't looked recently, but I looked a couple months ago, and I really want a job, but it doesn't look like there's any opportunities.
Okay, so the U6 measure is a broader unemployment measure trying to capture mm-hmm. the discouraged worker or the mm-hmm. worker is part-time, not really fully employed. All right, so you mentioned there's two main things that come out of this monthly mm-hmm. Report. Unemployment rate's one, and what's the other big headline data that comes out of that?
So it's non-farm payrolls, or just essentially how many new jobs were there added.
Okay.
So it's in 1 month, hey, there were this many people employed, and the new month, how many more were employed? To give it like kind of a feel for that number, in 2018, that's averaged about 180,000. So you had 180,000 people in that month get a new job. Like there were more. There was 180,000 some odd people employed in a month.
Okay. Now, is there a number? Is there like a threshold you want to get above to maintain, you know, full employment to make sure mm-hmm. everyone who wants a job gets a job? Is there some kind of cutoff? You rough number we know?
Well, there's a rough number which is you. So that's essentially the number to keep up with population growth.
Okay.
So that's the that's the rate of job growth to, you know, essentially keep the labor force fairly constant. And that number's actually shifted over time because of, you know, aging and slower population growth. So I believe it's around 90,000 now.
Okay.
So if you have a, you know, in a month you're adding 90,000, That's roughly
you're just breaking even.
You're just breaking even. And what's, I mean, what's really kind of stark and interesting is that in 2018, 9 years into the recovery from the Great Recession, we're adding about double that. If you think that there's, you know, the labor market's really, really super, super tight, maybe past full employment, employment growth shouldn't be growing that much because there should be fewer, you know, people out there on the sidelines to pull in. And yet 9 years in, we're still seeing really high and strong.
So we're seeing a consistent, one of the longest expansions or, you know, plain English, one of the longest runs where we've had quite a bit of robust employment growth every month. And then on top of that, we haven't seen like a big spike in wages. So if you would imagine if we were tapped out, we're just looking around the corner, where's someone who can come work for me? You start to bid wages up to pull them. We haven't seen that. So all of this circumstantial evidence suggests that there's still people on the sidelines, still residual people from the Great Recession who are just slowly working their way back in.
Yeah, that there's the hole that the Great Recession dug is really big and we are still climbing out. And while the unemployment rate's, you know, at 4%, that might not mean exactly what it did in 2000.
Yeah.
There's other signs out there that show, hey, we got room to run. We're still not completely out of a hole.
Well, Nick, this is a great segue because the unemployment measure is not doing a good job. There's all circumstantial evidence that says maybe there's still people looking. Do you have another measure? I know you do. I'm setting you up. Do you have another measure that is better informing, a better indicator?
So it's called the prime age employment rate or the prime age EPOP. So essentially it's a really simple number. So if you think of the employment rate is just how many people are there and what percent of those people have a job. And then prime age is saying, okay, well, you don't want to include in that population people under 25, basically people who are in school doing training, and then 55 and above. Those are people who are at the tail end of their career. Perhaps they're retiring. So you want to look at people who are in their prime working years. That's 25 to 54. So it's, hey, everyone between 25 and 54, do you have a job? Yes. Okay, cool. You get counted. And if you don't, then you're not in this measure. And what this measure does is it doesn't have the same problems that you have with unemployment rate due to changes in labor force participation rate. There's no kind of intermediate stage of, well, I don't have a job, but I think I'd want to look for one. And then making that decision in that fuzzy line between out of the labor force and in the labor force. This is just simply, it's binary. It's like, do you have a job or not? And I and a few others have shown that there's a fairly strong relationship between the level of the prime age employment rate and wage growth. In particular, this measure of wage growth from the employment cost index. That if you use, you know, you do a correlation or regression of the unemployment rate and wage growth, the unemployment rate isn't, you know, very good or predictive in the last couple of years. But the prime age employment rate is that every quarter when we get this employment cost index data, you can say beforehand, okay, based on data from the early 90s, we think wage growth is going to be this given what percent of prime age people had a job in that quarter. And in the last year or so, it's been pretty dead on that. You know, it predicts wage growth. And I think importantly for this conversation about Slack, that number, which is currently, 79.3, that's still a little bit below the level we saw in 2007 and still below the level that we saw in 2000. So it hasn't recovered from the Great Recession yet. And it didn't even recover from the 2000 recession.
Okay. So unlike the unemployment rate, which is, you know, well below, or it's crossed the point where it was before. So if you looked at the unemployment rate, you'd say, okay, we're back to normal. This other measure of yours, this employment rate for working age people, is actually indicating we still have some distance to go.
Yeah.
Now, I heard, I don't know if it was from you or one of these other authors that you've talked about, reframe the name of this, and they use the term working age employment rate. Mm-hmm. And that's an accessible way to market it. Because when you say, let me use a term that you almost use, prime age EPOP.
Yeah.
and that EPOP stands for employment population. That's just like you run that by the average person on the street. Hey, what's the prime age EPOP? And they're like, what? Yeah. But if you say working age employment rate, that's very intuitive, very clear. So there's some kind of marketing that needs to be done.
Yeah. Right? I used EPOP for the longest time in talking about this, and I would see people's eyes glaze over or just be like, what are you talking about? It's shorter, so it's easier on Twitter. But perhaps that's not the best
guideline.
Twitter
followers understand.
Yeah, that's, character limits and stuff, but perhaps not that's not the best guideline for discourse and how to actually engage with people. So yeah, I agree that using the employment rate, using working age, I'm not, because within the CPS, working age is like a slightly
Defined differently.
So I think I still like prime age, but
Oh, I see, because working age can be lower than 25.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fair. But the basic idea is able-bodied individuals,
people who
would
expect to work, what percentage of
what percentage of them? Yeah. Much easier. Okay, so that measure tells us there's still room to go. Our recovery still has a life left. Unless the Fed cuts it short, recoveries don't die of old age. They die of recessions caused by bad policy or incorrect policy. Okay, we've gone through all of those. Let's now move to another interesting measure of the labor market, one that you've been champion, and I would dare say one of the better known champions of, and that's JOLTS. So you mentioned earlier the employment numbers that come out, the number of new jobs created. That's actually a big deal, the job day report. Quick question, let me go back to that. Why does the market care so much about the employment numbers every month? I mean, it's like the stock market responds. Mm-hmm. Interest rates on treasuries respond. What is it about the employment numbers that people care about so much?
So that employment report is the highest frequency, high quality data that we have on the U.S. labor market. So if you want a good snapshot of the health of the labor market in 1 month, those data are going to be your best indicators. And I think the reason why the market and the media covers it so much is because, I mean, for the last decade, this has been, the Great Recession and its recovery, incredibly important. And also, therefore, the Fed's been really interested on this. So you'll have some reports where I think earlier this year, there was a spike in wage growth. And the markets were like, oh, this means the Fed's going to increase
interest rates
and it's going to be, have this huge importance. It's the best possible data that we have. It also is subject to revision, and it's 1 month, and there are margin of error. So the next month, the wage growth number jumped down a little bit, and I was like, "Oh, wait." So it's incredibly important. It's high frequency. It's the highest quality. It basically is a good indicator of what's going on in the labor market.
And so markets think the Fed's going to respond to this, tighten lower rates. One other thing, I know we need to get to JOLTS. One other thing about the employment numbers, number of jobs created. Is, that we talk about the numbers for the last month. What were they last month? 180,000?
Around that.
Okay. The truth is that it actually wasn't 180,000. Those are seasonally adjusted numbers.
Yes, they're seasonally adjusted with a margin of error.
So it's kind of, bizarre. I mean, it's appropriate on one hand, but on the other hand, if you were really honest with the person on the street, how many jobs were there last month? There might be some number way different than 180,000, but it's what we use because we have something to compare it to the previous month, right?
Exactly. Yeah. That there's, these data go back to the 40s. So there's a long baseline of reference, but it is true in moments where we're all having, people are on Twitter, responding to things. It's, perhaps it would do us some good to remember, there's margins of errors.
Well,
that's 1 month.
I mean, and this generally is not an issue. Seasonally adjusting your data is not an issue, and it makes a lot of sense.
Because
you don't at the end of the year, if there's a big pickup in Christmas or holiday season hiring, you don't want to confuse that for a sustained change or trend. However, there has been a problem, right? How do you properly seasonally adjust? And wasn't there an issue a year or two ago that was brought up that the Great Recession is such a big disaster, it's kind of messed up the ability to seasonally adjust your data?
Yeah, so there was an issue with the GDP reports, Q1, that there was, the term is residual seasonality, that seemingly Q1 GDP reports were always low, were consistently low, that it seemed like, hey, it looks like the seasonal adjustment isn't picking up, that, the Q1 in 2008, in 2009, well, particularly 2009, was not great. So that seasonal adjustment kind of was shifting down growth in the out years. My understanding is the BEA has dealt with that or is
okay, so working on it.
Yeah.
All right. So we have to be honest that this data is seasonally adjusted. Mm-hmm. All right, let's move to JOLTS. Now, I want to make sure we don't, for the older listeners my age, Nick obviously is a little, quite a bit younger than me, but those of us who are, you know, live in the 1980s might be confused with the original energy drink called Jolt. I don't know if you've ever heard of Jolt, but it was the original. They didn't call it energy drink, but I remember the ad back then was all the sugar, twice the caffeine. And that was pretty radical in the 80s. You know, I was like, whoa, my parents wouldn't let me near one, of course.
Oh, boy.
And now the Jolt would be mild. But so for the old listeners, we're not talking about famous energy drink. We're talking about a labor market measure. So tell us about it.
Yeah. So JOLTS stands for the Job Openings and Labor Turnover Survey. So what these data are, if you think about the employment situation there. So we were talking about that, you know, how many net jobs were added on net in a month, like 180,000. So for the purpose of the example, let's just round up to 200,000 so I can do math here in my head. Often in news reports, that number will get reported as, oh, this is how many people were hired in a month. Technically not true. That's how many jobs are added on net to the labor market. For actually, the number of people hired in a month can be like 5.4 million people.
Wow.
So it's that number you get from the jobs report is, okay, the total level increased by 200,000 people, jobs. Thing is, jobs also get destroyed and jobs get created. So in a month, there's lots of churn going on that people get laid off, people quit their jobs, but then also people get hired, either if they've had it, they're already employed or out of the labor force or unemployed. So a month where 200,000 jobs get added on net could be the result of 5.2 million jobs being destroyed, so 5.2 million separations and 5.4 million hires. So it's a bit like an iceberg. You see that little bit above the water. That's the kind of net employment number, but there's all this stuff going underneath the water.
Yeah.
That's a lot of the gross turn.
So net versus gross.
Yeah.
It could be huge gross turnover. And they have a number of indicators. So they have hires and you have separations.
Yeah.
In the JOLTS data. And they got under the category of separations, they got quits, layoffs, and discharges. And one of the kind of counterintuitive things, at least when you first think about it, for me at least, is that quits may be a good thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
You'd think quits. Why, you know, if someone quits, is that different than like layoffs and discharges? And why would we be excited to see quits go up?
Yeah. So you think of all these kind of separations. There's, you know, like a relationship, a job can end for two ways because one side ends it, like the employer says, you know what, this is not tenuous anymore. And then on the other side, the worker saying, you know what, I'm moving on. I'm doing something else. So when the labor market is, you know, bad, rough, recession, most of the time what you're going to see is a lot of those separations are going to be mostly discharge or layoffs. People, you know, employers saying, we're not making money. We can't afford to pay this labor cost anymore. We're letting you go. And quits go down because people who do have a job are looking around the labor market.
They're hanging on to dear life.
And they're like, and they're realizing there's not many opportunities out there. I need this job. I need to pay my bills. But then as the labor market gets stronger and, you know, the economy is healthier, businesses are making more money, they can not only, you know, hold on to the workers that they're already employing, they're probably ramping up hiring as well. And on the other side, workers are looking around saying, there's opportunity now. There's all these like open jobs. I can maybe apply to one or get recruited and get hired. So as the labor market tightens, more and more people are realizing, are getting job opportunity, are getting like offers, or they're saying, oh, I'm going to go look, find one and leave. So they're saying they're ending. They are the reason for the separation. And that's called quitting. So quitting is the sign of a healthier labor market, that people are looking around and seeing more opportunities. They feel they have some bargaining power. Hopefully they're getting a raise or, you know, better kind of benefits or working conditions. So they're moving on. And that's also other employers hiring them. So you have this kind of like people going up the job ladder, basically. Maybe a recession, they were in a job and it wasn't a great fit for them. But then as, you know, the labor market gets healthier, there's some other employer has posted a job. They think, this worker thinks, I'd be great for that job. I have the right qualifications, better pay or benefits. And they apply to it and they get hired and they move up. So that new employer is expanding, hired a new worker. And then the worker themselves hopefully got a pay raise. And then the old employer turns around and says, well, we had to fill so-and-so's old job. turn around, if it's maybe it's like an entry level job, hey, this person, you know, just looking for a job for the first time in a while, we hire them up. So people kind of get pulled into the labor market through that chain of events. So it's, yeah, it's counterintuitive. Quitting has a negative connotation, but in this sense, a higher rate of people quitting is a good thing.
Yeah, so we want to see the quit rate high. Now, how far back does the JOLTS data go?
It only goes back to December of 2000, which is when
data. But it would be great to see this data, if it were available, back into the 90s, because I imagine the late 90s, the quit rate would have been really, really high, right?
Yeah, so there's actually, it's not exactly the same thing, but there's been some research done using kind of micro data from the CPS, because they had a question in the early 90s that essentially was, are you employed? Yes. Are you working for the same people you were working for last month? Some researchers used that and managed to get kind of a measure of what the employment to employment flows, which is basically you were employed and you got another job. And that number you look at, it was rising and high in the 90s, goes down after the 2000 recession, goes back up a little bit before 2007, and then goes down. And it's been increasing a little bit, but not that much since the Great Recession.
Yeah. So just to put this in context, the late 90s, mid to late 90s is considered one of the more recent examples of a very healthy labor market where people find lots of jobs, robust turnover. Mm-hmm. It's a good time to be a worker.
Yep.
Whereas, you know, the 2000 to the really the recent period, 2008 to the recent period has been, you know, there's more power on the employer side, the firm side, because there's abundance of people.
Yeah.
Economy's weak. So it means more choices for the worker if you got higher quit rates. So
yeah.
When I quit my academic job and I came here, that would have been a sign that things were getting at least one little data point. And,
yeah.
And you went from previous employer to Indeed. Did you make a joke about this on Twitter?
So the JOLTS data come out 2 months after the kind of reference period. So it was August when the June data came out and I switched jobs in June. And I was actually on vacation. And so Sam Bell was thinking, are you really going to miss this report? And I said, of course I'm not. Like, it's the one I hypothetically would be in. So
I contributed to the JOLTS report. Yes. Yeah. No, it's a great thing. I mean, when you can, again, you know, like I enjoyed my previous job and at a university, but you know, just a new interesting opportunity came up. And with better pay, and I took it here at the Mercatus Center, but that's a sign that there's healthy churn in the labor market. So, okay, let's talk about another indicator. So, before we leave JOLTS, I just want to let Nick say one last thing. You are a big fan and you promote JOLTS Day.
Yes.
So tell us, for our listeners, when does JOLTS Day occur relative to the job day?
So usually it is the Tuesday after jobs day. So if jobs day is Friday morning, most of the time, it's the Tuesday after at 10 a.m.
Okay.
So,
mark your calendars. JOLTS Day.
Mark your calendars. And it's at 10 a.m., not 8:30 a.m. So if you like to sleep in a little bit,
there you go.
It's slightly easier to follow along with.
especially for those who are maybe in the central time zone and beyond, they can appreciate the folks putting JOLTS Day a little bit later in the morning. Mm. Okay. Let's go to the beverage curve. This is another labor market indicator that was used a lot and talked a lot about during the Great Recession. What is it?
Yeah. So one of the series we get from JOLTS is job openings. This is how many vacant jobs there are, how many, you know, potential hiring, what's the amount of jobs that employers would like to hire but haven't filled quite yet. And so what the beverage curve does is essentially look at the relationship between, you know, the level of job openings relative to total employment versus the unemployment rate. So the idea being it should be like a downward, again, verbally graphing here, so bear with me. The idea is that there's an inverse relationship, that it's a downward sloping line, that as, you know, employers are increasing job vacancies, that they want to hire more, the unemployment rate should go down as workers who are unemployed are flowing into those jobs. So when the unemployment rate goes down, job openings should go up. And when job openings go down, the unemployment rate should go down. The issue is that you had this kind of like clear line from 2001 to 2007 prior to the recession. And then as we started recovering from the Great Recession, what people saw is that job openings started increasing, but the unemployment rate wasn't falling as much as you would have expected given that prior relationship. So it seemed, to use the terminology, that the curve had shifted out. some people looked at this in 2010, 2011 and said, ah, the reason this has happened is because workers are unable to fill, unemployed workers are unable to get hired by these workers, by these firms. The firms are posting vacant jobs they'd like to hire, but they're looking at the unemployed workers and not hiring them for some reason. And so that was an argument for this kind of structural unemployment.
Another
story.
Structural argument.
What happened over time is as we got more and more data and the recovery started strengthening, that employers still were posting more jobs, but the unemployment rate kept dropping and dropping. So it was shifting back over towards that 2001 to 2007 line. And now, if you look at the most recent data, it's hard to distinguish points from the latest data in 2018 from 2001. It looks like that the relationship between
still a robust, sound relationship.
It looks like it was prior to the recession.
Okay.
So that shift out that got interpreted as a structural issue with unemployed workers, it's hard to buy that story now.
So really, there's been a lot of interesting arguments put forth through different measures, through the unemployment rate, through the labor force participation rate, through the beverage curve, where people were all saying anywhere from like 2011 to 2014, you know, the part of the labor market that was affected by the Great Recession is over. Anything else is all structural. And, you know, structure, we can't change it with monetary policy. We can't change it with, you know, goosing up or stimulating the economy. So just to sit back, accept our fate.
Mm-hmm.
And what all of these measures have shown, all of them to the last one, have shown that given enough time to heal, given, you know, a robust economy, mm-hmm. they actually were pointing towards cyclical excesses left. They were pointing to people still sitting on the margin who now can come into the labor market. So it's a good thing that the Fed did take its time. Mm-hmm. And one can argue, and Adam Ozimek's on the show, you know, he's made this point. I think you've made this point that you can argue right now whether they're getting ahead of themselves, but mm-hmm. the more general point is over the past decade, it's probably good that they did take as much time as they did in keeping monetary policy easy and normalizing monetary policy.
Yeah. So I totally agree with that assessment that, you know, five or so years ago, there are lots of people out there saying, we've done it. We've kind of, there's nothing more we can do. You know, it's unfortunate, but it's perhaps we could have done more in 2008, 2009 to help people, but there's hysteresis that people are locked out, that there's damage is done and it's kind of hard to reverse it with the kind of tools of monetary and fiscal policy.
Yep.
And I think what the last 5 years has shown is that those people were too pessimistic about the people ability of, you know, a tighter labor market to actually pull people in.
Nick, this gets us to a point that J.W. Mason made on this show and that others have made as well, that to some extent, not fully, but to some extent, that the supply side of the economy, the potential, its capacity can be influenced by how hot you run the economy, by demand. You know, and the analogy I like to use, and I've used it before multiple times on the show, so some listeners will recognize this, is that if you're someone who, you know, was bench pressing 500 pounds, I'm sure that was you, Nick, 500 pound bench press, and then suddenly this big disease, this big crisis hits you, mm-hmm. and you're not going to the gym, you're not exercising, that's the equivalent of a recession, the Great Recession, suddenly your bench press falls down to 200 pounds. You've lost 300 pounds, and that's truly kind of your, at the moment, that is your capacity. And you could just give up. Oh, it's all over bench press, 200 pounds. Mm-hmm. But if you go back and you work hard, you pick up the heat, you know, you get things going, you gradually can work back up to that 500. Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of what we're seeing here. So that the structuralists would have said, 200 pounds is all we can bench press in the U.S. economy. Mm-hmm. And the others were saying, well, let's at least try. Let's just try for 300. Let's try for 400. Let's go to 500. Let's get back to where we were. And I think that's the point J.W. Mason made and that others have been making. And so now the debate would be, well, let's keep pushing the limits. Let's see if we can get back up to 500 pounds in our bench press.
Yeah. And I think the argument is that, you know, in particular, let me put it this way. Just go back to kind of this labor force participation rate. If you looked at the data, you realize that a lot of these people were dropping out because they didn't see any opportunity. So this, I think you were hearing stories of people saying, oh, well, it's people don't want to work, or there's just like employers just don't want to hire them, without getting to the point of, well, we don't see any evidence of them not hiring. that there is a story of, oh, there's something like scarring from these workers. And while there are, you know, supply side issues with the labor market, I think since the Great Recession, it's been fairly clear that most issues were demand side, that you can't really get a test of these hypotheses of like, oh, they won't hire them until you get to the point that you can actually see that. And I think one of the issues with macro policy sometimes is that a hesitancy to get to that point where you're actually seeing if people like testing these hypotheses, because, you know, there's been talk about, you know, if the unemployment rate gets too low, inflation might pick up, like the Phillips curve relationship. And I think, you know, the last couple of years have shown that that's fairly flat, that you can let unemployment be quite low and perhaps be below its natural rate, and inflation is not going to pick up that much. So the cost for doing these kind of pushing on how strong the labor market can get is fairly small. So, you know, for example, the Federal Reserve has a dual mandate. One of them is, you know, inflation. You want to keep that, you know, those expectations firm and around 2%. But also you want to make sure that as many people can get employed as possible, this maximum employment, and this hesitancy to really truly test the limits of maximum, I think is borne out. Could be an issue.
So in that regards, President Trump actually is doing an amazing thing. He's running a kind of a natural experiment, right? His fiscal policies are pushing up against what the Fed wants, but they are adding a whole lot of extra heat to the economy. And if the Fed does tolerate it, it'll be interesting to see how far this can go. Well, in the time we have left, I want to move away from cyclical stories, which we completely agree on, to genuine structural stories. So long-term developments that did exist before the Great Recession, legitimate issues. And I want to speak about an interesting phenomenon. And this has been men's labor force participation rate. So the number of men who actually are in the labor force has declined for a long time. Mm. I mean, even I was looking all the way back from the 1950s to the present, there's been kind of almost like a straight line, not quite, but kind of a declining. And if my numbers were right, I was looking at a FRED database, like in 1950, 87% of men were in the labor force. Now it's down in the 60s. Why is that the case? What's happening that men are on a kind of persistent basis leaving? So again, we're not talking about the cyclical part. We're talking about kind of this long-term, multi-decade story. Why are men not in the labor force as much as they used to be?
Yeah. So I think that trend gets even more striking when you cut it by prime age. So it's 25 to 54. Prime age male participation was in the 90s, like 95%, mid to late 60s. And now it's also dropped. And what's really striking about this is that, so male participation has been going down while female has been going up.
Yes.
So that's, I think, an important context there. So it's because if you look at the aggregate outbreak by gender, it kind of is going up until 2000 and then starts going down. It starts going down in 2000 when women's participation rate starts going down.
Okay.
But to turn back to men, I think there was a really excellent report by the Council of Economic Advisors back in 2016 that kind of looked at these questions and tried to untangle them, looked at the literature. And what they point out is that a lot of this decline in the male labor force participation rate is of workers who have less education, so lower wage, less skilled workers. And that's really, you know, it's been declining for pretty much all male groups, but it's been strongest for these folks at the end of the skill or wage distribution. And so you think about, okay, well, this is, if you think about labor supply as a labor force participation as a labor supply, what's causing this? Could it be that, you know, men have decided, oh, I don't need to work anymore? You could look at, oh, there's an increasing female participation rate. Maybe, you know, men are married to women who are increasing work more, and maybe I don't know where to work. I don't need to work. Like, there's some supply side shock there. But if that were true, you'd expect wages for the prime age men, and particularly at the bottom, to be going up more. But what we've actually seen has been a relative decline in wages of low-income, low-wage men, the same group that's been dropping out of labor force. So it's been this reduction in supply, but also reduction in the price. That indicates it's more like a structural decline demand for these kind of workers. So that might point towards automation or increased international competition due to globalization as potential forces that are reducing demand or changing demand for the kind of skills that people have, and that's reduced the demand for these kind of workers and has resulted in them dropping out of the labor market. Part of this, too, could also be kind of government institutions that aren't, you know, like job retraining, those kind of issues aren't doing a good enough job, or like kind of active labor market policies aren't doing enough or could be reformed
to retool them.
To retool people, yeah. Help them like find jobs that like could be a good fit for them. And that there's an opportunity to reverse this structural trend, but a lot of it is just that there seem to be fewer opportunities for employment for those kind of workers.
So this is kind of the hollowing out of the middle class argument. Is it David Autor who makes this mm-hmm. case that if you look at where the job growth has been, really the creative class, the high skilled folks, lots of robust growth there, mm-hmm. low end jobs that don't require much education, but very like interactive, you know, one-on-one, where females have probably been engaged a lot more. In fact, there's some interesting pieces that some of these men are reluctant to take on roles that they think are for women.
Yeah.
So the low educated, the men with, you know, high school degree or less, or they're, you know, too much machismo, don't want to do a job that a woman should do. So that also, but the bigger story is just kind of the hollowing out of the jobs that you could use to do due to automation, robots, machines, and then globalization. And so, this is not going to go away, right? This will continue to be a problem moving forward. And it's going to be a change in education priorities, change in the opportunity for retooling, mm-hmm. right?
And I think also you perhaps like showing people, hey, there are good paying jobs that you might not think are like jobs for you, like nursing.
Right.
There's like a shortage of, you know, nursing talent right. out there. Lots of men could do those jobs, but it's traditionally been a female one. So it's kind of the change in norms.
So change in culture and norms. Yeah. Yeah. So over time, maybe that will be a fix for that. So there's definitely issues, long-term issues in our labor market that need to be worked out. We focused mostly on cyclical, you know, the result of the Great Recession. We have a few minutes left. There's a few more things I'd like to get to. I don't have time to do all of them. But there's been some other developments that we've talked about on the show. I'd like to hear your take on them. Again, long-term structural developments. I want to mention this, just a few. One, there's been declining fertility rates. So we're having fewer babies, which is kind of a natural byproduct of being an advanced economy and women going to work, more opportunities for them, the higher opportunity costs for children. You add on top of that, kind of the administration now is really pushing for lower legal immigration, you know, so we're not going to get that. So this, you know, I, my own fear is it affects future labor supply force. But on top of that, we have, you know, declining labor mobility. So people aren't packing up and moving to where the jobs are. Mm-hmm. What is your take on this and where do you see it going?
Yeah. So I think there's this interesting interplay between future labor supply and current labor supply. So you think about, for example, like fertility rates, that there's lower fertility rates, and that's going to have an effect on future amount of workers out there. But there's also the fact that part of the reason you're seeing declining fertility rates is also, you know, couples, women would like to have more children, but they're having that, there's, you know, the working arrangements we have in the United States are not conducive to like work-life balance. So that actually, there's been research looking at since 2000 in the U.S., women's participation has been going down. In other high-income countries, it hasn't. It's been flat to rising in some. One big difference between the United States and those countries is the U.S. has less
parental leave. Yeah.
Like no paid, like it's not legislated in the United States to pay a paid leave, but in other countries it is. And there's just other institutions set up to help parents deal with, you know, raising a child and working in the paid labor force, so that it could be, on the one hand, you could have a kid, but you might find it difficult to stay in the labor force. So that could be pulling down, you know, current. Or someone would say, well, I enjoy my career. I'd like to stick around and advance in it, but they're having fewer kids. So it's this interplay of, okay, also it could be pulling down current labor supply and projecting forward.
And is there any evidence in the research literature that there's ways to reverse that? I mean, or is it – can we get fertility rates up? Is that an easy task or not?
I'll be frank. I don't know that research quite well. But I think, you know, fertility might be hard to, you know, increase. But
that's my sense too.
Yeah, but if you want to increase labor supply, there are lots of people out there who would like to work in the United States.
So legal immigration.
Legal immigration.
Right. No, I agree. That to me is one another concern I have where the administration is going. We need more legal immigrants, their education, they bring their human capital in, and where they're going. What is your take on the declining labor mobility in the U.S.? Why aren't people packing up and moving to places where there are jobs?
Yeah. So I think there's kind of two interesting hypotheses. I think this is a really important open question. I don't really have a firm handle on what's going on. One, I think, is there's research that, you know, the main reason why people pack up and move is because they got a new job. And there seemingly has been a decline in the return to getting a new job. So that if the bump from getting a new job is less, then you're going to be less likely to move. Another hypothesis is labor markets are actually getting more similar across the country. For example, more people work in healthcare. Healthcare is kind of in every city. There's less incentive to go move because you're not, hey, this industry is only in that city. There tends to be more jobs. So it's a big and important open question, but I think those are kind of two.
So there could be a benign reason for the decline in labor mobility we would be too worried about, but there's more of a malign interpretation. So which one it is consequential. So, okay, with that, our time is up. Our guest today has been Nick Bunker. Nick, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thanks so much for having me.
Macro Musings is produced by the Mercatus Center at George Mason University. If you haven't already, please subscribe via iTunes or your favorite podcast app. And while you're there, please consider rating us and leaving a review. This helps other thoughtful people like you find the podcast. Thanks for listening.